You are live. God bless everyone. We want to thank you for joining us on this beautiful, glorious day. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Today, I'm excited to have some special guests. We have some extraordinary people who's going to join us after we start our presentation. They are going to come forward with information that you may never known of. Some of this stuff haven't been taught in the books that our children read, and it's not a part of their curriculum. But there's rich history throughout the world of past and contemporary men and women who broke barriers, who overcame limits, who inspired many generations to be the best version of themselves. They were restricted due to systematic racism. They was restricted because of their gender. It seemed like their past would have eliminated them from opportunities in their future. But these individuals, they overcame barriers of adoption, of being abused, of being looked at as less than a citizen, and they broke records. They went beyond what people expected, and they did great things. Today, we are excited that Colossus Hope Church, under the leadership of Dr. Linda Janey and her daughters and grandchildren, are going to join us as we celebrate not only Black History Month this month, but we celebrate in Black History Month throughout the world. So I want you to listen, invite your children to listen, and understand that this is a moment to celebrate diversity. After the countdown, you will see a short slideshow. And after that, we will have prayer by Elder Lachelle. And we're going to go for it with a selection from our MTCW choir. And following that, we will begin with my sunshine and with Christian. All right. God bless and enjoy.
African-American who made a hot comb and a product to grow your hair. She was a single mother and very poor, and she suffered from a scalp disease that made her hair fall out. And since she washed people clothes, she found ingredients to make something to grow her hair back out. And she found it, and people around her saw that her hair was growing. So she first started going to towns and cities to tell everybody, and she made a deal with people. If I can do your treatment for free if you buy it for 10 cents. And that's when she started becoming famous and a first African-American millionaire. And she later died from heart disease, kidney failure.
What did you learn from her?
That no matter what your skin color is, you can still do something big, and no matter what you go through, you can still do find something and encourage other people to do other things that they would like to do.
Good. Let's give her a hand, everybody. Yay!
Hi, my name is Emmanuel, and I was learning about Kelly. He was one of the first Black people to play soccer. He was one of the most greatest soccer players, and he broke many records. In 1957, he was one of the world's greatest soccer player ever. He scored 58 goals. And he got married with two daughters and one son. And what I learned from him is that you should never quit.
Where did he live in?
Brazil. Brazil. He lived in Brazil.
Awesome. We have some excellent good news about South America being influenced by African descent. And his name again was? What's his name again?
Polly.
Polly was a famous soccer player. And we know in Brazil and in Spain, they call soccer what?
Football.
So we are grateful to know that African history do not just begin in America. It has spread around the world. And we thank God for Sister, as she brought forth the amazing word about Madam C.J. Walker. And this is a contemporary C.J. Walker. She do her hair, she do her siblings' hair, and she is a very amazing entrepreneur. And so I'm grateful to have these two come forward first. And I wonder, do we have Lachelle, if you would not mind, Elder Lachelle, just taking us before the throne of grace, before we go into our next stage.
Amen. Thank you, Elder. It's just an honor and joy to be here. And thank you, Lord, for putting this vision inside of Elder Henry's heart to lay it to provide educational resources to our youth, to show them their roots, because you need to know where you come from to know who you are. I thank you for the grace and the glory that all the wisdom and witty ideas and adventures that you've placed in these youth that are gathered here with us, because they are our future. And it's because of them that we will continue to succeed as a mankind in harmony and unity. Dear God, I thank you for giving them the courage to do this, because it's not easy to get on in front of people, but you've given them the courage and the power to be able to empower others. And I ask that you bring your glory in everything that they do and everything we do on this line today, so that everyone can see your light through them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. That's one of the strengths of our community is prayer. God knows we wouldn't have made it through a lot of the oppression and a lot of the different adversities that came against us if it wasn't for prayer, if it wasn't for the songs that inspired us as our ancestors went through hardships and trials. So we are grateful for the awesome prayer by Elder Lachelle. Would one of your daughters be available to give us some of their inspiration today?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, my name is Leela Ross, and today I will be talking about Amanda Gorman for Black History Month. Amanda Gorman is a 23-year-old poet and book writer. She's the first person ever to be named National Youth Poet Laureate. Gorman was born in Los Angeles, California on March 7th, 1998. She was raised by her single mother, Joan Wicks, a sixth grade English teacher in Watts. She is one of three children. She has a twin sister, Gabrielle, who is an activist and filmmaker, and it is unclear of her other siblings' age, name, or gender. She was born with a speech impediment and went to Harvard University. Recently, Amanda Gorman has recited an original poem, The Hill We Climb, at President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris's inauguration. She's the youngest poet to speak at a presidential inauguration. Here are some lines from the poem. When day comes, we ask ourselves where we can find light in this never-ending shade. The loss we carry, the sea we must wade. We've braved the belly of the beast. We've learned that quiet isn't always peace. And the norms and notions of what just is isn't always justice. And yet the dawn is ours. Before we knew it, somehow we do it. Somehow we've weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. Amanda Gorman has successfully written many poems, including The Hill We Climb, In This Place, An American Lyric, and The Miracle of Morning. She has also written some books, including, Change Sings, A Children's Anthem, and The Hill We Climb, and other poems. Thank you for joining me and talking about today's Black History Person.
Let's give her a hand, everybody. And to everyone who went before, let me give you a hand. You tell me that this young lady is only 21, correct?
She's 23.
23. And she's already written all of that literature. That lets you know that age have nothing to do with it. Do y'all know a biblical character who had a speech impediment or a speech problem? Start with an M.
Moses.
Oh. You know, it's amazing that God called great people, but sometimes great people have limitations. Maybe they born with different limits, but it don't mean that the limit is going to stop you from living a limitless life. Moses brought his excuses and said, you know what, God, I'm not fit to speak in front of Pharaoh. I have a slow speech. Some believed he had a stammering problem. Some people stutter, and it makes them feel so nervous to even speak publicly because they don't want others to laugh at them. But God gave Moses this word of encouragement. He said, who created the tongue? Am I the one that makes the mouth? And if I put the tongue in your mouth, surely I can put my words in your mouth. So I just want to share that to anybody who ever been discouraged about speaking in front of others. Understand Luke 12:12 says, I will give you what to say at that hour. Don't be afraid of men in their faces. She did something that never been done in history. And what if she allowed excuses to hold her back? She did not allow her limitations to define how far she could go. And it took her from her humble town to the White House on that historic day where we saw our first female African-American vice president.
Yeah.
May history be good to you all, but history will be good to you once you can see the goodness in yourself and you do not allow your excuses to hold you back. Amen. Oh, this is so good, so good, so good, so good. Now we're going to have, hallelujah, Royal come forward and Imani. All right. He will be covering the African diaspora from Asia.
Hello, everybody. My name is Royal, and I'm doing Yaske. In the late 15,000s, Jesuit priests enslaved a towering young man from somewhere in Central or Western Africa during a missionary trip to Japan. Mm-hmm. This slave was immediately has immediately became the center of attention. Mm-hmm. A 17th century book that describes him as dark as charcoal with charcoal, a person unlike anyone the Japanese had seen before, and the he had strength of 10 men, and he became a samurai because he started off as a guard.
Just now give him a summary of what you just read. Just talk to him.
What
was his name?
His name is Yasuke. And to me, his story was becoming the first black samurai.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
So this girl was Simone. She wanted her parents got into a fight, and first she gave up on gymnastics, and then she wanted to come back because she wanted to win a lot of gold medals. And then she wanted to do gymnastics a lot.
And what's her name again?
Simone.
All right. So we have so far the Diaspora of Japan that was done by Royal. He brought to us the first African samurai. Oh my God, they say he had the strength of 10 men. And the funny story about it was when the Asian emperor saw him, he thought he was dirty. He thought it was an Asian person covered in black paint. So they had the man take a shower, and they found out he really was that color. But he possessed strength that they said was the amount of 10 men. And he became a samurai, which was like equivalent to a knight in Europe. And so I just want to thank the kids for their boldness and their willingness to just express and to introduce to some things that we didn't learn until we was older. So y'all kids got a big advantage. All right. So now we have our sister Lachey, and I know her mother going to wrap it up. Our last two presentations. Let's go.
Hi, my name is Lachey, and the person I will be doing is Alfred L. Crail. Alfred Crail was an African-American businessman and inventor who was best known for inventing the ice cream scoop in 1896. Crail was born on September 4th, 1866, in Cambridge, Lewisburg, County, Virginia, just after the American Civil War. He attended local schools and worked for his father in carpentry trade as a young man. During that period, he also became interested in mechanics. He did not become famous for it. Crail was also a successful Pittsburgh business promoter as well. when Black local investors created the Afro-American Financial Accumulating Merchandise and Business Association in Pittsburgh, he was selected as an assistant manager. He did not become famous for inventing his ice cream scoop. It spread widely so quickly that people soon forgot or never knew that Crow was the inventor. Thus, he never profited from his invention. Married and with three children, Crow experienced a number of personal tragedies. His wife and one of his daughters died in 1918 of communicable disease. In 1920, he lost his only son to another disease. With that, that's Crail's only surviving immediate family was his daughter, Anna Crail, born in 1910. Later in 1920, Crail himself was killed in an automobile accident in Pittsburgh.
Wow, that's amazing. So that brother is the reason why I love ice cream.
Yeah.
Okay, now I understand. Oh wow, we need to get a picture of him. He need a holiday named after him. He really do.
Yes.
But I'm so empowered and so excited to find out these hidden treasures that's been hidden, but they coming out. That's one thing for sure. Time will always reveal the greatness inside of you. It may happen 10 years from now. It may happen 50 years, but your name will be remembered. The Bible says in the book of Psalms that the righteous name and legacy will last forever. So continue to do the great work you're doing. Moving on, we have the amazing Elder Lachelle. And following that, we would love to have, I would love to share some free remarks. And then after that, I will turn it over to Dr. Linda Janey to give some remarks. Amen.
Thank you. I am going to talk a little bit about South America and Central America. And in talking with that, I am going to share my screen here. So I'm going to try and get it up. All right. Share my screen. Sometimes technology tries to work against us, but that's all right. It's going to work. Okay, there we go. So everybody should be able to see my screen, correct?
No. I can see.
Elder Henry, can you see my screen? Hello? You can see it? Okay. So
yes,
I want to talk a little bit about Black history in Central and South America, and just for a few minutes, because I didn't realize, I actually had learned something when I was doing this presentation. A lot of times we think of Blacks coming over to America, we always think they came to the United States first. However, the first place that Blacks were brought over from Africa was actually Central and South America. And they are known as the Latin community or the Afro-Latinas community. And the Latin American and Caribbean regions were the first areas to be populated by African immigrants due to slavery. Almost every Black in South America are descendants of Africans that were imported there between 1518 and 1873. And even today in Central America, many Afro-Caribbean islanders arrived in Panama, and they are the ones who built the Panama Canal. So without our ancestors, we would not have the Panama Canal that gets us to Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua, and Costa Rica. And they also were the ones that did the work for the banana and sugarcane plantation. So for all y'all that love banana and sugar, because you know we can't have all our sweets without sugar, our people were the ones that grew those things, that grew those crops for us to be able to have that. The regions in South America and Central America with the largest concentrations are Northeastern Brazil, the interiors of Suriname, Guyana, and French Guyana, the youngest of Bolivia and the northwest coast of Ecuador, the Pacific and the Caribbean coast, and the Caucasus Valley of Colombia, along with Llanos, and that's where most of and Venezuela, where most of our African ancestors, descendants have today. I just want to clarify, because a lot of time we hear the term Afro-Latin Americans and Black Latin Americans. Well, actually, that's a U.S. phrase that we use here. Most in the countries where these descendants and these natives live, they use other terms. So in the United States, we use Afro-Latinas or Black Latins, but in their country, they use the words like Negro, Negro, Preto, or No. And they or also they go by their nationality, such as Afro-Brazilian, Afro-Cuban, and Afro-Haitian. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention, because I learned that myself. I thought that everywhere they would call Afro-Latin Americans, but that's something that we in the United States refer to them as. And I just wanted to show you a picture of some of the few famous Afro-Latinas. Everybody here likes to dance. We got a lot of dancers on the line. So Celia Cruz, she is the queen of salsa. She created the salsa dance, which is strongly influenced by the African heritage, and she gained popularity from her singing and dancing. And also here, I know all of y'all have watched Avengers Endgame or seen Guardians of the Galaxy. The key lead lady, and Lachey has to help me with her name. Pronounce her name for me.
Her name is Gamora.
Gamora, thank you. That is Zoe Saldana. She is one of an African co-Latina born in the Dominican. Her father's from the Dominican and her mother's from Puerto Rico. And we also have Elizabeth Acevedo, who's a poet and author, and she used her experiences as an Afro-Latina in writing her poetry and has gained international success. Also, Maritza Correa McClendon is the first Black Puerto Rican to join the United States Olympic team. She was born with scoliosis, and a doctor suggested that she swim to help her with that disease, and that disease allowed her to be the first Black Puerto Rican to join the U.S. swimming team for the Olympics. And also, some of you may have heard about the Tuskegee Airmen who fought in World War II, and Esteban Edward de Jesus Esteban Hotese was the only known Dominican to serve as Tuskegee Airmen. And so for those of y'all that don't know, the Tuskegee Airmen were a group of Black airmen that fought in World War II, and they were very prestigious, and mostly all of them have received presidential awards for that. And for some of y'all that love sports, especially baseball, y'all have heard of Sandman or Mo, whose name is actually Mariano Rivera. And he played for the New York Yankees and went to the world championship with baseball 5 times. He was also Afro-Latina. So I just wanted to point out a few people just to share that, just to remind you that people in the United States are not the only ones that have made contribution, but it also around the world, as you learned earlier today, and also in Central and South America as well. And when I was reading, I found this very interesting quote about Jamaica, and I'm going to read it. It says, "We are neither Africans, though we are most of us Black, nor are we Anglo-Saxon. Though some of us will have others to believe this, we are Jamaicans. And what does that mean? We are a mixture of races living in perfect harmony, and as such provide a useful lesson to a world torn apart by race and prejudice." Mm-hmm. And Jamaica, the country of Jamaica, their national identity is based on their understanding of racial prejudice. They accept people of all colors, and no matter how you look, and they live together in harmony. And they are the country which is leading the way that hopefully worldwide will teach people that we don't have to really worry about the color of our skin, because we all have something to contribute. And they are one of the only country that has progress in developing a non-racial society in which color is not significant. So they are a role model for the rest of the world that we all should follow. And I just want to close out, as y'all know, music is a universal language. So this is a medley song where it sings a couple of different Christian verses in different languages. So I would just want to play a little bit of it so you can hear some of the music from that region from a Christian perspective. And then it's the language melody by Donnie McClurkin. Give me 1 second, because I'm going to start it. I'm not going to play all of it, but I'm just going to play a couple of minutes of it so you can hear it.
No, it's not registering. And when you go down the song, man, you know, there's a song that I sing, and it just simply goes, God of day, one boom, God of day. See, now in Suriname, they scream like we've just said something great, and y'all sitting there saying, what? We're going to try it again. God of day, one boom, God of day.
see, the reason why a lot of you aren't dancing is because you don't know what in the name of God I just said. Well, let me bring it to your culture in America so you can understand. God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
Here, but I wanted to share that with you. Oops, I'm sorry. I wanted to share that with you to let you know that here you have Donnie McClurkin, a world-renowned artist who is using his gift to share the word of God with others through music, which is the universal language that he travels all right. If you listen to the whole song, he actually sings it in 19 different languages. So he is an African-American influencer that's making a difference today around the world as well by using his gift of music. And I'm going to turn it over now to Dr. Linda C. Janey.
Amen. Wow. Young people, you all are great. You have done excellent. And What really made me start thinking is that it's not the color of your skin, it's not the texture of your hair that makes you great, it's what's inside of you, it's how you think, it's how you see yourself, and it's also what you know. And I got to thinking about thoughts of scripture, and I got a little bit of word in here, and but all the way back to the beginning with Genesis. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. Now I'm going to read them to you. This is God speaking. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our own likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth and over all the creatures that move among the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So what this is saying, young people, you are created in the image of God. So God is black, God is white, God is Japanese, he's yellow, he's red. In his image, God created us. And we have to get it in our mind and understanding that it is what's in our heart and look at how we think, which enables us to be. So if you think of yourself as being great, you are great. You need to learn your history. You all did such an excellent job today and going back, doing your research and finding out how great, there's so many great people. You know, us Black folks, we take nothing and create something that's wonderful and that can be used throughout the world. So I just want to say, God bless you all and keep it up. Keep learning. Keep thinking how great you are. Keep looking at your past. Live in your present and think about where you want to be in the future. Because I see the presence. I see the doctors. I see the lawyers. I see the inventors. You all are so great. I get so inspired. You see the greatness in you. So I just want to share that with you all. No matter what anybody say, what anybody does not say, you don't need no one to pat you on the back to tell you who you are, because you know who you are. I am made in the image of God. And there's nothing, no one greater than God. Therefore, I too am great. Amen.
Okay, we're going to turn it back over to Elder Henry.
Thank you, everybody. Good work.
Everyone, turn it
up. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on around the table. We're going to close out with this last message that I want to share. Everyone, you all bless my life, and you all have really done an amazing job. Dr. Elder was all up in my message about Genesis 1:26 through 27, but I'm going to add Psalms 139, and I'm going to braid it along with what she just said. And I want to encourage you with the verse that said that I am fearfully and wonderfully made. That's right, Royal. You, my brothers and my sisters, were customized, masterpiece, created, customized by God. You was formed not by the opinions of others, but you was formed by the love of God, by his need of you in the earth. You was a receiver of his love because you was created from his love. And perfect love drives out all fears, all insecurities. However, there has been a lot of stigmas that's been put on this culture. There's been many stigmas placed on every culture, but I just want to focus on this culture. Many stigmas of facial prejudice. Just because your nose may be a certain size, just because your eyes may be a certain size, just because your lips may be a certain size, I'm here to tell you that you are made in the image of God. Just because your weight may not match our brothers and sisters from other culture weight, it do not eliminate that you are a piece of the master. I just want to let you know that just because your hair texture maybe a little bit different from other of our brothers and sisters' hair texture, it does not mean that your hair texture is insignificant. Because my God tells me that he know every hair on your head. Come on, somebody. Head up outside. He knows the sparrow that falls from the ground, and he knows you by name. The Bible tells me that when he made Adam out the ground, the Hebrew word for Adam is red. Okay, and when you look up the word Adam, it means rooty brown red, that he made us from the soil, from the dust of the earth, and he breathed on man the breath of life. And I just want you to know, great men, that don't allow society to continue to paint a picture that all men are violent, that all men are bound for prison, that all men are uneducated. There was a saying that if you want to keep something from a black person, put it in a book. But God is raising up men that are making the lies of Satan a lie. God is raising up young boys that's going to make Satan eat his words. Hallelujah. And we don't have to wait for judgment day. He's doing it today. He's doing it. Hallelujah. In the past, and he's going to do greater things in the future. God has allowed a lot of objections to come our way. But I want us to use it as fuel. Use it as fuel. Every embarrassing moment, every stigma, every comment, use it as fuel to focus on your dreams, to focus on the gifts that God put inside of you. Don't allow the excuses and the no's of others stop you from getting through that front door. You don't have to lower your morals. You don't have to lower your values in order to get through the back door. God is so big, he can open the front door for you. Let me break that down for you. So in other words, in order for you to become successful, you don't have to smoke or do drugs to get there. Shortcuts cut people short. My daughters of God, you don't have to show forth your body and expose your body in order to get on front of a magazine. You don't have to show what God has redeemed as precious to the world in order to get that record deal. I learned from Cicely Tyson that when you stand to your morals, after a while, that door will open for you. She was a vegan, and a person wanted her to participate on Elle magazine. And guess what? The guy said, here, eat this ice cream. She said, I'm sorry, I won't eat ice cream. He picked it up and tried to put it in her mouth and said, eat the ice cream. She said, maybe you didn't hear me. I don't eat ice cream. I'm a vegan. I don't eat dairy products. The guy said, well, I guess we're not going to do the deal for you. You might as well go back to America. You're not going to ever appear on Elle magazine. 40 years later, at the age of 92, Cicely Tyson appeared on a magazine. That's right. She may have been older, but guess what? When God opened your set time of favor, no man can stop it. And I bet that person who said she would never be on a magazine is probably dead. The same person who said the Bible would never be printed out on his press, ink press, actually died, and they used his ink press to print out the Bible. What I'm trying to say, you do not have to compromise your values that you learned from your family in order to reach success. I don't care how good it look. I don't care what videos go viral. I don't care what people are doing on TikTok in order to get a million views. You don't stoop down on your value as princes and as princesses in order to get popularity and notoriety. The Bible lets me know that God knows every star by name. And there's over 100 billion stars in our solar system alone. He's not going to forget you. If he know every star, how are he going to forget you? He said, I know the plans I have for you. Plans not of evil, but plans to give you hope and a future. Do you not know that God's plan is for you to have prosperity and success in your life? Do y'all know that? Come on, talk. Then y'all will have to learn to wait on the Lord, trust in him, and be bold and very courageous. I remember Muhammad Ali. Y'all familiar with him? The boxer who said, I learned how to jab, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee.
Yeah.
His two daughters was about to leave out. It was on a summer day, and they was wearing some short clothes. It was pretty revealing. And he stopped, and he gently brought them into the living room, and he said, do you know the most precious things in the earth is covered up? Don't you know in order to get a clam, you got to go into the ocean and grab a clam, pull its shell open, and there you will find pearls that's worth thousands of dollars. Don't you know in order to find gold, you got to dig into the earth in order to take the gold from the earth? Don't you know in order to find diamonds, you have to dig to find it. In other words, we are precious. You don't have to reveal what others want you to in order for you to get to where you want to get. You can keep your integrity. You can look like queens and prince. You can be clothed with the garment of praise. For God have not only called you to praise him, but he called you to be admired, where people look at you and they will see honor, integrity, value. What we wear can influence the attention we receive. But I declare and decree this day that the sons and daughters of God is covered in a garment of praise, that you're going to arise and shine, for the light of God is upon you. You in this dark world, the reason why you still in this land, the reason why the pandemic did not destroy you is because you need it in this generation. For such a time as this, although we're going through racial problems still today, it was just in 1960 that our grandparents was allowed to vote for free. It wasn't long ago. It wasn't long ago that interracial marriages was actually legal. It was in the 1960s. But still, there's so much worth fighting for. I'm progressing in age. A lot of us are adults are progressing in age, and we are passing the torch to you all to do greater works than we have done. You are called, and that's what the enemy wanted to do. He wanted to break up the structure of generations, where the younger people don't want to hear the older people, and the older people get so frustrated with the younger people that they begin to just say, just let them figure out on their own. But the devil is a liar. He's bridging the gaps that the enemy thought he was going to destroy. The Bible says a house divided cannot stand. But let's believe and decree unity. Let's decree and believe healing. Let's decree and believe collaboration. As I said before, it's no big eyes. There's no little U's. But together, we can take the principles of Kwanzaa. Together, we can take the words of the Bible. Together, we can take the teachings that inspired Martin Luther King to do a peaceful protest that created a movement that's transcending time. Together, we can do great and marvelous things. And so I'm glad to know that the light of hope for the future, Dr. Jenny, is still bright. Hallelujah. The light for the future, Elder LaShaw, is still bright. For when we see what our children have done today, it lets us know there's still more for us than against us. Hallelujah. So in closing, I just want to pray. In closing, I just want to pray peace, joy, protection, healing. May your home be surrounded with God's angels. May he bring to your mind his goodwill for your life. May you be in health. May you prosper. Even the years that the enemy have eaten up, I'm praying for God to restore those years. I'm praying for opportunities that may have been missed, that they will come back in front of you. I'm praying today in areas of bitterness that God will give you sweetness. I'm believing God that history will be good to you, that time and chance will meet and destiny will meet with your greatness, and you two will collide. I decree and declare it, that now unto him who's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ever ask or think according to his power that's working through us, may your light shine. May your light shine. May the rhythm on your heart continue to beat. May the song in your heart continue to encourage you and drive you. May you continue to do what God called you to do. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Everybody, let's come around. and wave everybody goodbye and say God bless, and we love you all.
Love you too.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you for joining us.
Our pleasure. Thank you for having us.
And last thing before we end the live, please look up Colossians Hope Ministry, Colossian Hope Church. I would like y'all to give it your information. So if anybody wants to find you on social media, they can look you up.
Thank you, Elder Pastor. You can join us on Facebook at Colossal Hope Church. Colossal Church.
Awesome. Thank you. And you can also let us know about the charity that your daughters are doing.
Okay. Lachey, do you want to talk about it or you want me to talk about it?
Happiness for the homeless.
Happiness for the homeless.
Is a nonprofit that gets donations from people, They give out little bags of clothes, hats, scarves, gloves, things like that, to the homeless, and we give out scarves, hats, gloves, and socks. But in the summer, we'll give out like little care packages. And then we also give out care packages with toothpaste, soap, and little things like that.
Thank you. And I will sum it up. The thing, like Lachey says, she does Happiness for the Homeless. She calls them Bags of Hope. And we do them year-round in the colder months. Like she said, we have colder things in the summer. We have things. But the thing that I really want to highlight about this, Lachey started this when she was 5, because she said God told her that everybody should have a place to live and to lay their head. So this is something where she has humbled me and made me look at things a little differently. So I'm thankful for that, because this is her ministry that we all help her with. And Colossal Enterprise is a corporate sponsor. We've had some other corporate sponsors in the past as well. But the thing is, it took out a child to bring a humility to me as an adult to remember that we're here for a purpose to help others.
Well, there you got it, my brothers and my sisters. Please look them up. They're an amazing family. They are an amazing group of inspiring individuals that believe in family, that believe in community. Dr. Linda is a retired judge. Oh, my God. And a seasoned, am I telling the truth, right? And to me, that's historic. That's historic. And I just know that there's so much wisdom and knowledge. And I want anyone who's listening, please look them up. Please support them. Please pour on the wealth of wisdom and knowledge that this amazing family have, because they all about helping each other and helping you. Amen. Well, we love you all. And we thank you for joining us at More Than Conquerors Worldwide Ministries. And on behalf of our youth ministry, they want to say something.
We love you.
We love you.
God bless you.
God bless you.
God bless.
Love you guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.